I'd like to welcome you to MCC. My name is Cassandra Butts, and I'm the senior advisor here at the Millennium Challenge Corporation to our CEO, Daniel Yohannes, and I bring you greetings from Daniel. I am very pleased to be here to introduce our panel discussion, or to give you greetings and then turn it over to Alina to introduce the panel discussion. At MCC, gender equality has been a priority, and this is actually the fifth year anniversary of our gender equality policy. We have been incredibly proud to be a leading edge agency within the U.S. government focused on gender equality and development assistance, and it's certainly consistent with the approach the Obama administration has taken in highlighting gender equality across development assistance. And we saw that very recently with the announcement of USAID with their new gender equality policy. So it is something that we're doing across the USG, and we're pleased to actually have an opportunity to host this panel discussion. Not only have we been in the cutting edge, but we're not standing still in terms of our work on gender policy or gender equality at MCC. Just last year, we actually introduced a new policy indicator called Gender in the Economy. And those of you who know MCC know that with our policy indicators, we use them to measure the ability of a country to actually take advantage or to qualify for funding from MCC. And the Gender in the Economy indicator actually measures using an IFC, Women, Business, and the Law report to determine whether countries actually do have gender equality and gender rights that allow men and women to take advantage of or to be able to participate in the economy equally. So we're really pleased that we actually have the ability to measure countries not only in how they're implementing the funds that we provide to them, but also how they're doing on the policy front. And my colleague, Alicia Mandeville Phillips, here led the effort actually to put forward that gender in the economy indicator. So we're making progress, and we're very pleased to be here today and to host this panel discussion. So I'll turn it over to Alina to introduce the panelists. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and especially thank you to MCC for hosting this event. My name is Alina Zhishkovsky, and I'm a long-term SID-Washington board member. So I'm going to give my little SID-Washington spiel to you and then turn it over to Jenny Klugman to actually do the introductions of the panelists that we have today. For those of you who are not familiar with the Society for International Development, we're an international organization. This is the Washington, D.C. chapter that's hosting this event. You can find more information right outside the door. The main things that we always encourage people to do is to become a member. So pick out the sheet or go online to www.sidw.org. We like to think of ourselves as the global town square for development, since it's one of the few places that everybody is welcome, the government, the NGOs, the private sector, all sorts of non-traditional players that are part of international development. And we do a lot of different kinds of events. One of the big things that we do is our annual conference. So we do have flyers about that. It's coming up in June. It'll be June 5th, and the theme is the future of development, the challenges ahead. And we also are going to have, this is our chapter event in honor of International Women's Day for this month. Next month, it'll be a focus on innovative finance. So if you come to our website, you'll see some more information about that. And we also wanted to mention that we have a work group on gender and development, so that if you are interested in this topic and you want to get involved in a work group or come to some of our work group events around this issue, we do that year-round. And certainly also the SID staff would be happy to tell you more about it. And I do want to take this time to thank the SID staff for arranging this, especially for Sally, who's a wonderful staff member, and very much appreciate her efforts on this event. And again, thank you to our very distinguished panel. Thank you for taking the time to come to this event and to lead our discussion. So I'm going to turn it over to Jenny, and thank you very much.
So I'm very happy to be moderating this event today at the Millennium Challenge Corporation, such an august panel of distinguished speakers about whom I'll introduce in a moment. My name's Jenny Klugman. I'm the relatively new still Director of Gender and Development at the World Bank. And just to set the stage, what I thought I would do would be to highlight some relevant aspects from our recent World Development Report on gender equality, summaries of which are available outside. It was published in the fall. It was the first ever World Development Report on the topic of gender. Many, I think all of you here would feel that it was long overdue, but I think that many also feel that it's made an important contribution to the debates. And one of the areas where it I think makes an important contribution is quite systematically documenting the scale and pace of improvements in women's lives, women's and girls' lives over the past 25 years, I think at a rate of which was unimaginable at that time. And there's a series of areas where there has been important progress, including, for example, in access to university education. So access to university education is now 7 times higher than it was 40 years ago. So women now, females now, comprise the majority of tertiary students around the world. Women in low-income countries now live 20 years longer on average than they did in 1960, another important achievement. But at the same time, I think you're all very well aware that there are egregious gaps still in terms of achievements. One area which is highlighted in the report, not a new area, Amartya Sen, among others, did work on this decades ago, is around the issue of missing women and girls. And so we present new estimates of the scale of this phenomena, this problem, and estimate that 3.9 women and girls each year are missing, and that 2/5 of whom are never born, and that's due to a some preference at birth. A 6th die in early childhood, many because of unsafe water and sanitation, and over a 1/3 die in their reproductive years. So that's really a shocking statistic, I think, for us to be bearing in mind even while we celebrate progress. And as you all know as well, there are very important gaps in terms of access to productive resources, to land, and in voice and participation. And so what this report does, I think importantly for the World Bank, although again it's not new for many of you, is to argue that this is important as a matter of rights. It's the intrinsic value of gender equality is very firmly recognised in this report. But another advantage of the report, I think, especially for the bank, because we're in dialogue with finance ministers and planning ministers and governments around the world, is that documenting the case that it's smart economics, the business case, if you like, for addressing this, because the costs of disempowerment are very large, and we also show that they're growing in a globalised world in a whole range of ways. And so the costs of inequality are not only to the women and girls and their families themselves, but the broader society and broader economy. And so what the report does is show how addressing these challenges can bring progress more generally. So these are some of that's just to set the stage very briefly for I think, a very interesting discussion this afternoon. The order in which we're going to run is the order in which I'll just introduce our panellists now. Ginny Seitz, I think, is probably known to many of you. She's the Senior Director of Social and Gender Assessment in the Environment and Social Assessment Division of the MCC. And so she's responsible for looking at operations. She's also been responsible for developing the guidance, which I think has been in place for many years, and also coordinating internal capacity building. So there are all issues, certainly at the World Bank, that we're struggling with. So I'm very much looking forward to hearing about how the MCC has experienced its challenges in terms of gender integration. Karen Sherman, an old friend, but also now Executive Director for Global Programs at Women for Women International. And so she provides, in that role, leadership and strategic oversight of Women for Women's global programs in accordance with the overall mission of serving women survivors of war and conflict. And so she's going to focus in particular on obstacles which are faced, knowing Karen, particularly on the ground in the work that they're doing. Next, we'll have Gina Rice-Wilchins, who's the director of the Girl Up campaign at the United Nations Foundation. And this is a very interesting and innovative program to build and maintain a constituency dedicated to this important issue, in particular reaching hard-to-reach girls around the world. And the slogan, if you like, For Girls, By Girls, I think is very interesting. We'll hear more about that and its outreach to adolescent girls around the world. And she'll talk about where we're going
And then finally, but certainly not least, Alice Nelson, who's the President and Chief Executive Officer of Vital Voices, will present. Alice, many of you may know, she co-founded Vital Voices some dozen years ago, served as the Vice President and Senior Director of Programs there before assuming her current role. And she's worked with women leaders around the world and an incredibly interesting program. And what Alice is going to do is to have a more forward-looking presentation about how we're going to get there and some of the approaches adopted to address some of these issues. So each of the speakers will present for around 10 minutes each. I'll try and keep them more or less to time, so they'll be highlighting their main points. Obviously, there's a much more that could be said in each of the other areas, but then we'll have about half an hour, hopefully, for questions and some lively discussion. So thanks to our panel, and they can sit or stand depending upon what you prefer.
I'm going to sit, and hopefully you can all hear me. MCC's experience with gender equality and women's empowerment, I think, has been unique within the development community. As the gender advocacy groups realized in 2005, MCC was especially well-positioned to mainstream gender in our work. We were, and still are, a new development agency. We are committed to policy and institutional reform, including in our selection process, as Cassandra just mentioned. And we engage in substantive due diligence of proposed projects and, most important, rigorous performance monitoring and impact evaluation. More important, MCC's mission of poverty reduction through economic growth allows us to bring attention to the economic sectors, an area where gender integration has lagged behind the traditional women's social sectors like education and health, although the World Development Report has corrected some of that. MCC received much attention for our gender policy when it was released a little over 5 years ago. It simply states that MCC recognizes that gender inequality can be a significant constraint to economic growth and poverty reduction, and that both MCC and our country partners will ensure that gender is integrated into the selection, consultations, project design, monitoring, and evaluation. But no policy, however good it is, no matter how much attention it receives, can stand alone. Between 2007 and 2011, we learned with our country partners how difficult it is to do gender integration. Yet, at the same time, we had many successes. Among them was the decision to condition the Lesotho Compact on passing a law that established gender equality and economic rights. Our compacts in Nicaragua and Honduras became models for gender in land titling, agricultural producer services, and in designing gender-responsive resettlement projects associated with road construction. There are many, many more examples, but what became clearer and clearer to us and our partners was that we needed operational procedures and milestones to ensure that gender integration was consistently more than a policy ideal. We looked again to what the advocacy community had identified as the key requirements for gender integration. We'd already done well with the first two, leadership and mandate, in that we had a good gender policy backed by support from our CEO and senior management. And with the Obama administration, that was scaled up with the involvement of Cassandra as our gender champion. But we found challenges with the remaining requirements, capacity, resources, and accountability. In March of 2011, MCC formalized operational procedures and milestones for gender integration, which hold the agency and our country partners accountable in new ways. First, we've staffed up the Social and Gender Assessment Group at MCC and now require that a senior social scientist with gender expertise is on our partner country's team from the beginning of compact development. And that makes all the difference in the world. We require initial analytical work to identify social inequalities in law, policy, and institutions that are barriers to poverty reduction. And every compact must have an approved gender integration plan prior to the second disbursement of funds. We ensure adequate budgets for gender-related work, including all social assessments. We also have requirements not only for sex disaggregated data, but for gender integration and project monitoring and impact evaluation. What is most important is that we are reaching towards the normalization of gender analysis in our agency's way of doing business, and in doing so, also affecting the way our country partners respond to gender equality and women's empowerment. The 2012 World Development Report has been a useful tool for us for making the case in our new partner countries that this is an accepted concern and central issue in development. And our management at all levels ensures that gender is always part of their engagement with our MCA partner countries. So these operational procedures and milestones, which are called the Gender Integration Guidelines, as well as our gender policy, can be found on the MCC website, and I encourage you to review them, as well as information about our new gender indicator. In addition, this past year, MCC began using that new eligibility indicator called Gender in the Economy, based on the IFC's Women, Business, and the Law report. It's an excellent proxy for issues covered within our gender policy, and in a sense comes full circle to the issues we identified 5 years ago with the government of Lesotho as a reason why we were going to condition the compact. In the last month or so, I've been in El Salvador, Lesotho, Namibia, and Ghana. There is a remarkable change in how gender is being considered as new compacts are being developed. In El Salvador, for example, I was asked to present MCC's approach and requirements to the government's interministerial council. And El Salvador's gender lead for the second compact is from the technical secretariat and is a key member of the team developing their concept papers. In the first compact, the government was not interested in appointing anyone with gender expertise to their team and resisted having a staff person with that responsibility. Moving forward, we now have opportunities with our partners in current compacts to push gender reforms and accomplishments beyond the life of the compact. In Lesotho, we expect to see the reform of customary law. We expect to see the reform of customary law to achieve gender equality and the substantial institutionalization across government ministries of gender beyond the appointment of the usual focal person. And I say that, you know, I was just in meetings with the Ministry of Gender and other ministries, and I really do see us having opportunities to substantially push these things forward in ways that I haven't seen before. In Namibia, we're modeling a training program that the Ministry of Lands can use in future to ensure women's land rights. For MCC, sustainability is the next challenge, and that includes what we have modeled and achieved in gender. As we move forward, we can work with our partner governments towards the goal of gender equality and women's empowerment becoming part of their ongoing policy, institutional, and operational procedures. Thank you.
I think I might stand so I can see everybody on the other side of the room.
Well, that's better. Good afternoon, everybody. So I'm Karen Sherman with Women for Women International, and Women for Women works with women survivors of war and conflict and post-conflict zones around the world, all of the hot spots that you know. We're in four African countries. Louder? Is that better? No? Is there a volume button here? Okay. I'll try and scream. We're working in four African countries, Rwanda, Congo, Nigeria, and South Sudan, and then we work in Afghanistan and Iraq, Bosnia, and Kosovo. So really running the spectrum of hot conflict, protracted conflict, and post-conflict zones. And our program vision is really to help to create lasting change for women and their families, who will in turn be able to drive change for their communities and societies more broadly. And we do this through this idea of creating access to resources, meaning that women are able to earn and sustain an income, but also knowledge and rights. So this idea that when women know their rights and are informed about the choices that they have, combined with access to resources, it's those two things together which create lasting change for women. That one without the other is not sufficient to be able to, for women to make change on a long-term basis. And our program is aligned with four key outcomes. One, that women are well, meaning that they have a basic level of physical and psychological wellness. Two, that women are decision makers, meaning that they're able to contribute to decisions within the family and community. Three, that they have rebuilt social networks and safety nets, which is especially important for women survivors of war who have really lost everything to war and conflict. Families, you know, children, rape and torture victims. We are really talking about the most marginalized, excluded women. Some of them were that before the war, and even more so after the war. And finally, and perhaps most importantly, that women are able to earn and sustain an income. And it's when these four outcomes are met that women are able to drive change, not just for themselves, but within their families and in society more broadly. So we have a core 12-month program that every woman goes through, whether she's in Bosnia and Kosovo or Rwanda or South Sudan, aligned with those key outcomes. And so we supplement this rights training with business training, numeracy training if women need it, and then vocational skills training tied to local market opportunities. So really a combination of hard skills as well as soft skills. And the monitoring and evaluation that we do with the program is critical. I know for everybody who's been doing this work a long time, we talk about incessantly the need for data. Data to be able to make the case for investing in women and girls. Data so that we know that our programs are being as effective as possible. And also data to say, hey, this isn't working as well as we thought. We need to make changes here. So Women for Women is all about data. And I'll talk a little bit more about that as I walk through the presentation. So since 1993, we're almost 20 years old, we've worked with over 300,000 women survivors of war throughout these different countries and have distributed $104 million in direct aid and microfinance loans to these women. So I was asked to talk a little bit about some of the specific challenges and opportunities. As Jenny said, I'm going to talk about the field because that's really where all the work is, and that's where we're seeing progress. But, you know, I see the challenges for women, particularly on the economic front, as threefold. One is this access to skills and knowledge. Two being access to resources, and Jenny talked a little bit about this, the land issue, microfinance, markets, other things. And then finally, and perhaps most importantly, the traditional mindset and social and cultural norms which hold women's progress back. And I'm not just talking about men and communities, but I'm talking about women themselves, restricting what they can do and what they think they can accomplish. So talk a little bit about this, the skills and knowledge question, and then really how Women for Women addresses some of these challenges very practically with our programs. So the skills and knowledge, obviously we're working with the most excluded populations I mentioned as survivors of war, but 39% of women for participants, the highest level of education is primary schooling. So almost half of them have no formal education. 46% are literate and 27% enumerate. And in countries like Afghanistan and South Sudan, the numbers are really higher. 85% of our participants in Afghanistan are literate and enumerate. So it just gives you a sense of the context and also what the opportunity is in terms of real job placement and putting women out into the workforce who don't have a lot of natural skills in terms of their education. So the way that we've addressed this is through our integrated education program. It's this 12-month program that I talked about. So the program teaches women about the hard skills. I mentioned the business training, the vocational skills training, but also teaching them about their rights. And so we talk about in the training program rights around child custody, inheritance, domestic and sexual-based violence, children's education, family planning, voting, savings and financial management, and really helping women to understand that A, they have these rights, and B, what they can do if those rights are not protected in the family and community. In very few instances, I can think of Rwanda, for example, where if a man is violating a woman's rights, she has recourse and she can call up some kind of hotline and get some kind of action taken. The local community, local officials will intervene on her behalf. But in most of the other places we work, that is not even an option. So it's really incumbent upon the woman to understand and take action for those rights, not just even individually, but women in solidarity with each other. So we talk about that in our program. We're helping women, you know, economically, socially, psychologically, in terms of being war survivors, and helping them to come together collectively and be able to take action. There's so many examples in our program where a woman is suffering from violence in the community or in her home, where women who she's gone through training with come together and they're knocking on the hut door and they're saying, you know, if you're beating me, you're beating all of us. And it's that kind of solidarity where women are able to say, this practice has to stop. And so this group dynamic is really important. Some data points about that. For women who are going through our program, 91% of our graduates have an increased knowledge of their rights compared to 28% at enrollment. So that's a pretty significant change. Also, this question of health, 90% of women understand good nutrition, stress management, better health practices compared to 32% at enrollment. So we're checking women at baseline, we're checking women at exit, and then we go back 1 year and 2 years after women graduate this 12-month program to see how they're progressing. And then we talked about the economic aspects in particular. So when we go into a country or a new community, we do market assessments there to really look at the top income generation opportunities for women. So it looks different from country to country. And across those eight countries, we offer 46 different types of vocational tracks, anything from garment production in Afghanistan to ceramic tile making and brick making in Congo and Rwanda. We do large-scale commercial farming activities in South Sudan, Rwanda, and Congo, where we have actually received donated land by governments and community leaders to move women off subsistence farming and moving them into commercial farming, where obviously the economic gains are much greater. Food processing, trade and services, hairdressing, tailoring, things that we can provide specific training in but don't require a large or high education threshold that women who are going through our program are just simply not going to be able to meet. And again, on the data points, women who go through our program are earning, on average, about 37 cents per day at enrollment. And as women leave the program, $1.44, which may not sound like a lot, but is really life-changing in most of these contexts in which we work. Also, which we just got some new data in on the asset side, which I found really striking. And this was specifically for our four African countries. But so women's average assets were $22 at enrollment, $30 at graduation. But 1 year after women had left the program, they were worth $49, which I thought was a startling number, which tells me women are taking this money that they're earning and that they're investing them in different kinds of household assets, things that make the life better, improve the life for the family very specifically. So I thought that was a great number. Another good number from my perspective is that 88% of the graduates are engaged in some type of savings, whether it's personal savings, savings in community groups and things like that. Because savings really are a reflection, like I have a future. I'm investing in something that's going to help me and my family down the road. So I think that's a wonderful number. The second big challenge was this resource question that Jenny mentioned, access to major resources that women just by nature of being positioned or poorly positioned in these societies, land, capital, inputs, markets. Those are big obstacles for women in terms of them being able to make economic progress. And we've all heard the statistics. In developing countries, women produce 60 to 80% of the food crops, but own only 1% of the world's land and earn less than 10% of the world's income. Such a striking number. And we also know this number that when women are earning money, they invest 90% in their families. So also a great number. So you see the challenge and you see the opportunity right there. And there's a lot of, at least in the countries that we're working, there are a lot of formal and informal barriers to women increasing their assets, whether it is, you know, cultural barriers, customary laws around land ownership, inheritance laws. And so some of them we can address through our program interventions, and some of them require more sustained level of support intervention, particularly at a macro level, at a policy level, where others can be very involved in helping to drive change. The way we address some of this resource question is through these resource partnerships. I've been in this development business a long time, Jenny knows, 25 years, and there has never been a better time in my perspective to talk about women in development, women making progress, and the opportunities for resource partnerships, because for the private sector is, for the first time, not just saying, well, we should help some women because, you know what, they need help. Those poor women need help, and they're victims, but, you know, really like, oh my God, you know, if we're investing in women, it's a game changer for the family, those community society, it's actually a good business proposition. And so the time is really ripe for some of these resource partnerships. And so, you know, we've partnered with the governments, as I've mentioned, specifically around land access for women to enable this commercial farming. We formed some critical market partnerships as well. We've been working with Kate Spade New York, for example, since 2006. We started out very small, making handcrafted items for Kate Spade, about 700 units way back when. And last year, I know, 2 minutes, okay, I'm moving. Last year, we did 8,000 units for Kate Spade across Rwanda, Afghanistan, and Kosovo and Bosnia, to the tune of over 600 jobs for women. We're also working closely with the World Food Program, where we're selling our crops of maize and beans to them, and some other corporate partnerships, which are really paying off benefits in terms of women's jobs and income. And what I would say is they're not doing it for charity. It meets their business objective too. And in the case of Kate Spade, it helps build their brand, customer loyalty, and for us, jobs and income. I'll talk very quickly about the mindset, and then I will move on. This discriminatory cultural practices against women that are imposed on women not by communities, by men, and also by women themselves, restricting their participation because they've lost almost everything as a result of war, including their dignity and their hope. And so we work to change their mindsets in the course of our training, and also to enlighten men through our men's leadership training program, because if you're only dealing with women, it's half the equation, and we need to bring men along too. And maybe it's a good time to stop there, and hopefully in the discussion I can say more, but I appreciate your time and attention.
Good morning. I'm Gina Reese Wilchins. I'm the director of the Girl Up campaign at the United Nations Foundation. It's been a bit of a whirlwind in the last year since this campaign launched. Actually, we launched in 2010 in September. Just to step back a little bit to give you some history, though, in 1998, those of you probably remember where you were when Ted Turner made the announcement on CNN that he was giving $1 billion to start the UN Foundation. And his vision was quite brilliant, and I think the longer that I work with the UN Foundation, the more and more I see his brilliance and the vision that he started there, was about bringing the best ideas, connecting the best people and the best resources to help solve some of the world's hardest problems with the UN. Girl Up is really a culmination of 14 years of investments, $46 million to be exact, in adolescent girls' needs and rights across developing countries, and a 14-year commitment that we've invested in building programs with the United Nations Foundation. We are in 4 countries. We are in Ethiopia, Malawi, Guatemala, and Liberia, 3 in Africa and 1 in Latin America. And the goal of the Girl Up campaign is to engage American girls, 13 to 18 years old, adolescent girls, to help them channel their awareness and their passions into raising awareness and funds for some of the world's hardest to reach adolescent girls in developing countries. To give you an example, in 2005, The United Nations and the Nike Foundation invested in a program called Berhani Hewan. And one of the other things that I should say about Ted Turner is his vision was about stepping in and piloting and seeding the best programs that are on the ground so that they can be scaled up. So our goal is to be in these countries 2 to 3 years to give them the seed money that they need to grow potential programs to scale. And I'll give you an example of that. In 2005, when Nike and the United Nations Foundation invested in a program called Berhani Hewan in Ethiopia, and this was in the Amhara region. And what we are able to do is effectively delay 11,000 child marriages in the Amhara region for girls. And that was by going in and engaging with civil societies, going in and engaging with the leaders of the community and educating them about mostly men. You talk about bringing in men into half the equation and getting them, convincing them that it's the right thing. It's smart economics to invest in education in their daughter instead of marrying them off at 15. So the power in that story for me is not necessarily the 11,000 girls, which is fantastic, but now DFID has stepped in to take it to scale to impact 200,000 girls and replicate that model in other countries as well. So, and I had a chance to actually see our rural program, or that was our rural program, but our city program called Baratesva. This was a complementary program in the slums of Ethiopia, where I had a chance to meet a woman named Tigist, and she had, and most of the girls who come to this, who end up in this program, are girls who flee the rural setting because they're escaping from child marriage, and they're looking for opportunities. We have mentors who stand at the bus stop who obviously can identify these girls to see who they are and try to bring them into situations or get them some informal education and help them not get into sex trafficking situations or domestic labor. But Tigist escaped child marriage when she was 14. She is now one of the benefactors of our program at Baratesva. She's thriving. She's making her own living. She now has friends. One of the things that we hear that SID-US is so painful, especially for American girls, and I will get to our American girls, is that 1 in 5 girls in developing countries doesn't even have a friend. And for girls here, that's a big deal because friends are their is everything to them. So she finally has friends her own age. She's finally thriving, and she wants to get married someday and have kids on her own by choice. So that's just one example of the work that we're investing in. So what we're doing is we're raising money here in America to invest in UN programs on the ground in those countries, just to be clear. And what happened was 7 UN agencies came together and decided that they were going to, across their mandates and expertise, prioritize adolescent girls. So what we do is we work with usually a lead agency on the ground in those countries that partner with other agencies and other NGOs and governments to implement these what we call very comprehensive programs. And our 5 pillars are such as making sure a girl is educated, making sure that she is healthy, making sure that she is safe, making sure that she is counted. A lot of times these girls don't have birth certificates. We don't even know they exist, so how do we actually know what their needs are? And then making sure they're positioned to be leaders. One example of safety is we're paying for solar lamps in Somali refugee camps now in Jijiga. The really cool thing about that, it provides light for the girl who has to walk, obviously, for 7 to 8 hours a day to collect water, potentially at night, to save her from harm. She uses it to study with her homework, but then her mother is also using it for her business to charge cell phones for the community, in the community. So we're also looking at making sure that girls have separate latrines in the school so that they feel safe going to school. So that's obviously the future and the gap we're trying to fill in developing countries. But the American girls here are the real story. In the last year, we've been able to galvanize 220,000 girls to get involved in this global fight to solve these problems for girls in developing countries. We know that they're the right drivers to this solution. We did our research, and they are obviously, you know, if you have girls in your house or if you are a teen, they're already giving their time. They're already donating their money. They're already giving to causes that give back, like a Kate Spade, and they're investing their time. They're also listening to their mothers. I mean, they're twice as likely to invest their time and money into what their mothers are doing as well. So our girls are, they're doing a tremendous amount across the country. The goal is to get them to become philanthroteens. They are philanthroteens. What we call them, philanthroteens, are globally minded, socially connected, inspiring to their own community, and they're philanthropically engaged. And we give them the tools and the resource to actually become global leaders of tomorrow. We have 100 clubs, and I don't say this to brag, but we've done it without even trying. We've started in the last 3 to 4 months, and they are springing like wildfire. And I joke, every time I give a stat, I know that the next day it'll be higher. And we have 14 amazing teen advisors. These are our, the ambassadors of the program who are out there, the 1%, the cream of the crop, that are really helping us raise awareness and funds. I just came back from Seattle where I attended Priyanka Jane, who's one of our, she just turned 18 years old, and she hosted a mother-daughter tea to raise money for her counterparts in the developing countries, raised $25,000 in 1 hour. I don't know about you guys, but when I was 18 years old, I wasn't raising $25,000 for my counterparts. But they know, like Priyanka, when, you know, 1 in 7 girls are married before she's 15. And they are outraged that their counterparts have the same dreams, the same aspirations, but don't have the same opportunities that they have. And that's what's motivating them and driving them to actually do this work. 27,000 girls today will be married off. That's 10,000 girls who'll be robbed of their childhood. In fact, our girls are getting even more engaged in child marriage. There are some windows of opportunities that we're taking advantage of now with the administration, with the secretary, the State Department, Secretary Clinton. But last year, they took a bold step, and they were able to galvanize 16,000 signatures to deliver themselves to the Obama administration to help stop child marriage. And this year, they're going to even go even deeper and try to galvanize even more girls to get involved in this fight. So I think I'll stop there and hand the mic over to Elise.
Great. I'm going to stand up so I can see everybody.
Two stand.
I know.
That's good.
If I can make my way through the purses.
Good afternoon. I'm Elise Nelson, President and CEO of Vital Voices, and I always love sort of this International Women Week that seems to every year get bigger because I get to see all my old friends who I've worked with for so many years and, quite frankly, who I so admire, and I think we're all certainly in this together. You know, if you just look at International Women's Day, it's been around for, what, 101 years. That's what we're celebrating this year. But really, I have to tell you, and I think all the panelists here would agree, in the last 5 years, it's just exploded. I think 10 years ago, I would say to people, oh, you know, it's International Women's Day, and they'd look at me like, what? You know? And I think that that is quite indicative of just this larger movement of more corporations, countries, international institutions, studies coming out, really focusing on the important role of women in our world. And the fact that, you know, this is just simply a development imperative. It's not just the nice thing to do. It is indeed the smart thing to do. And, you know, I think for those of us who've worked in this sector for a long time, those in the panel certainly know that for so long we spoke in the language of fairness. And I think that that language of fairness or rights is certainly still relevant today. But over the last 5 years, there has been this sort of new language emerging. And really the idea that that economists have been talking about, that women and girls are actually one of the greatest sort of untapped potential in the world. And I think that all of us in this space are really using that as great momentum to really push through. And that's why I think partnership right now is so important. But I think what we've seen at Vital Voices and what we do is we really search the world for extraordinary untapped potential, women leaders, women working to combat violence against women in its various forms, whether it be child marriage or it be domestic violence or human trafficking or other culturally harmful practices. We also work with women leaders who are starting up and growing microcredit cooperatives that are serving hundreds, if not thousands, of people, or starting and growing businesses as entrepreneurs. And then we also work with political leaders. And I think what we've seen is a very interesting trend over the last 15 years of doing this, and we train and mentor women and support them in their growth as leaders. what we've seen is that once women get to the table, to decision-making table, they actually bring something very different. Women actually lead in a very different way. And it's fascinating because when I first really started on this journey, and I've conducted hundreds of interviews with women leaders, top women leaders, CEOs even in this country would say, no, women don't lead differently. We're really the same. We're just as qualified as men. And I was like, well, I'm not asking if you're qualified. I'm asking, you know, if women lead differently. And I think for a long time, we weren't willing to admit that women are actually different. And I think, I believe, not just think, but deeply believe that what women bring to the table as leaders is sorely needed in our world today. So if you think about it, women, in my opinion, are more cause-driven about their leadership. They typically come to their leadership path later in life, typically through experience, later in life than men, really through experience. They are driven by a cause in their community that ignites them, that gets them angry, that they're passionate about, and they step up to lead change around that. So I think that women do actually seek power in a very different way. They seek power to empower other people. They are also very inclusive and collaborative. So women know what it's like not to have their voices heard. They know what it's like to be left out of peace negotiations. They know what it's like not to be represented on the floor of parliament fighting for a particular issue. And so when they think about who's, you know, at the table and whose voices are being heard, they also think about who's not being heard. And so they tend to be far more collaborative, as I say, and inclusive. And what I wanted to do is just give you a couple examples of what I've seen in my work. So as you know, right now, the Middle East, obviously, is going through a lot of change. And we've been supporting and following women in the Middle East, you know, for our entire history, over 15 years. And there's a woman that we support there who's actually running for president. Her name is Bethana Camel. She is the only woman who's running, and she's doing something very, very different than her male other candidates who are running for president. She's going out all over the country and holding focus groups and listening to the concerns of people. And I was in Egypt in January, and we've asked her, you know, why are you doing this? Why is this so important to really, you know, travel around and hear these voices? And what she believes is that how can she possibly even say she's running for president if she doesn't know how her leadership would impact those that she's serving? And we hear that again and again from women really wanting to empathize, to listen, and to know the impact of their leadership on others. Another example, I just came back from Haiti about 6 days ago. And there we were working with a group of women that we've been supporting over the last 13 years. We have a Vital Voices chapter there, Femmes in Democracy. And as you know, of course, 2 years ago, they suffered the devastating earthquake. And really, in times of crisis, as I know Karen knows well, you know, women are typically the greatest victims. But we also believe, and I know Karen does as well, that they can be the greatest solution. And what we saw is that women in Haiti decided that they wanted to be part of that solution. Right now, women in Haiti only have 13% of seats in the parliament. There has been a tremendous rise of violence against women. Women are the last to, you know, gain employment opportunities. And so what they decided to do is travel all over the country. As you may know, in Haiti, things are very centralized in the capital. And they wanted to make this a totally, you know, consensus-building initiative. They traveled all over the country. They held focus groups with women leaders and also just women and men who were dealing with some of the challenges, you know, following that devastation earthquake. And they found, you know, not only what are the challenges, but what were women's priorities for solutions. And they put together the first ever national policy platform for women. And I was there with them, as I say, just 6 days ago, and we actually presented that policy platform to the president of their country. And it was very interesting because I wondered, you know, how would the president respond? And he responded very much like, we need women. I'm glad you're stepping up and wanting to be part of the solution. We need solutions right now. So I think that's just another example of the way that women lead. Bethana, I think, you know, shows that women are deeply rooted in the community and thinking very much empathetically about the way in which they're serving their people. Women in Haiti certainly are thinking about leadership and making change in terms of really building consensus. And the other thing that we've seen is that women gain opportunity, resources, connections, and they immediately return home from the different programs that were run, and they want to pay it forward or give it back. Women naturally want to connect and mentor and bring others along. It's just an extraordinary phenomenon, not wanting to keep the resources and opportunities for themselves. And certainly Karen talked about that, and women reinvesting 90% of their income in developing countries and their families and communities. We've certainly seen that with women we work with around the world. I just want to leave you with one final story, because I think it's been mentioned a couple times, the important role of men. And that's critical. And I know I was supposed to bring some solutions and ideas. And I think what I'd like to leave you with is a great story of a wonderful man named Sadu. He's a police officer in Cameroon, and he participated in a program that we ran. It's part of our global partnership to end violence against women in partnership with Avon Foundation, the makeup company. And what he did is he came on that program. Quite frankly, he had no idea why he was there. We had men. We had a number of NGO leaders from around the world. We had obviously law enforcement, judges, government ministers, people from the media, people from business across different sectors, men and women, all of whom were dedicated to stopping violence against women. But Sadu was like, you know, why am I here? And he started to hear about this issue of human trafficking. So he's from Cameroon, and he said, you know, this is amazing. I've seen this going on. I had no idea that this was trafficking. I didn't know what it was called. I didn't know that it should be illegal. I sort of knew it was happening. He went back totally ignited. He actually then did an investigation and was able to basically bust a brothel and free 98 women and children. And one day we got this email from Sadu, our human rights vice president got this email, and he basically documented every single one of their names for us because he wanted to let us know, you know, you opened my eyes to this. So, we at Vital Voices, we're not going in there and busting brothels. We are finding leaders around the world who are doing this, men and women, and we're looking at how do we sort of support them, stand behind them, inform them, get them to work with other partners to be able to achieve this. 8 months later, we traveled to Cameroon and worked with the government and a number of partners across different sectors, and actually were successful in reforming the anti-trafficking law. So that's just really an example of the power of leadership. And I think when we think about where we are right now and how there is so much focus on women's value to drive economic growth and development around the world, we can't just look at women as a number that's not being tapped. We also have to look at what is that different quality that women bring to the table when they are enabled to have their voices heard. And as I say, I think that women lead differently, and that difference in a world of increasing divides, inequities, you know, countries trying to come back and recover from economic crisis, having leaders that are more cause-driven and inclusive is just vitally important right now. Thank you.
It was great. I think it was quite an uplifting panel, which was great. I think that we heard some great stories about change and momentum at the policy level, country level, in terms of legal and policy reforms, stories about programs at the community level, at the individual level, very much multi-pronged approach, as well as the increasing interest, I think, and awareness from governments and corporations and so on. But let me open it up now for questions. We have, I've managed the time so well, we have half an hour for questions and discussion. So I think it'd be good to get a conversation going, so I would encourage you to make either comments or questions, keep them reasonably brief, and then we'll come back maybe after we've had a chance to listen to several and have some reactions from the panel. And if I can ask you to also introduce yourself. Thanks.
Yes, hello. My name is Antonio Calzada, and I'm with Calton Consultants, independent consultant. Thank you very much for, you know, all the stories, the data, the insightful details about your wonderful work. And I believe that this topic really bears deeply, into a very important intangible that is really construed by topics like respect, trust, and culture change. And so, kind of like with that in mind, I would like for a member of, or several members of the panel just to talk a little bit about this culture change, about how respect and trust has been gained. There was a comment from one of the panelists regarding a country where they have the Ministry of Gender. Well, why doesn't every country have a Ministry of Gender? So with that, I can leave it for the panel. Thank you.
Ready? Thank you so much. My name is Beth Hand, my company's leadership hand, and I'm really passionate about helping corporations with their corporate responsibility, not the social responsibility, but inevitably doing good businesses, you know, doing well. And but they're looking at, you know, global workforce issues, things like that, and I'm what is the linkage to, you know, with this people who are more developed, who are literate, who have, you know, can go into the workforce, and the poorest of the poor, people who are illiterate and innumerate. I need to know that for myself because I know where my heart is, but I also really want to tap this extraordinary power of corporations doing well.
Hello, I'm Andrea Berniski from Save the Children, and I want to address, there are a lot of statistics out there, especially lately, about keeping girls in school and the importance of keeping girls in schooling. What Save the Children has found is without quality education, that becomes almost meaningless. The girls actually do not learn to read, and they don't gain anything, and we are trying to really address this issue of quality. Of course, it's important for boys as well, but how can we, and what is your experience in addressing the issue of quality in education, not just a body in school, and how that contributes to girls' greater opportunities? Thank you.
Come back to the panel now and maybe take one or two of the questions each. And then we've got several more, I think, questions. Virginia. Okay.
Let me respond to your comment about respect and trust and ministries of gender. And I'll start by saying that, you know, we bring to this work, and particularly from the MCC's perspective, and I'm sure with all of the panelists who engage in partnerships, we work very closely with our country partners because we don't implement the programs they do. And when we engage in discussions around social change and the reform of social norms, we're doing so with our partners. We're not doing it on our own. At the same time, we always keep in mind that these involve basic human rights as well. But the approach is always collaborative. Regarding ministries of gender, most countries do have them, and they've had them basically to respond to donor pressures for quite a few years. Whether or not they actually are successful depends entirely on whether or not their policies, institutional structures, and mandates allow them to influence government policies and programs across many ministries. I'm sad to say that happens less often than we would like, but they are there, and the real challenge is to mainstream or integrate gender analysis into all government ministries so that it becomes reflexive in their work to consider how gender differences and inequalities affect their programs. Thank you.
I I'd like to address the global workforce question. I think it's a great question, actually. How do you serve the poorest of the poor and also make sure that, you know, corporations can get engaged and actually look to socially excluded women as a potential workforce issue? No? Don't touch it, right?
Hot stove.
It's interesting. We're actually in partnership with the Rwanda Workforce Authority on that very question, and they have a mandate of creating, turning Rwanda in essentially to a middle-class country over the next, by 2020. That is their Rwanda's Vision 2020. And obviously that's going to involve a great deal of women, particularly women at all levels of society, coming into the workforce in a significant way. It also commits them to job creation at a large level. And so, you know, what they've done, and I think it's really smart, is to create basically a spectrum of jobs, if you will, in some of the key priority sectors for that country. And there's jobs at lower levels that don't require a great deal of skills that women who are even illiterate and numerate but with some skill training can be most appropriate for, versus some higher level jobs that clearly you're going to want your more educated women, women who have very specific training, obviously literacy skills and numeracy skills. But they've understood that while the jobs may be here, the workforce is here, and we need to build that bridge. We need to build that bridge with vocational training programs, with education, and making sure that we can equalize what women have and what they bring to the table. So, for example, we have a partnership with a group called Aquila, because the hotel industry is totally developing in Rwanda, the hospitality industry, and we know that they're going to need thousands and thousands of jobs there, and they're going to need front office jobs and back office jobs. And while the women that go through our program, to the tune in Rwanda of almost 7,000 in a given year, a lot of those women would be very well qualified for some of those behind-the-scenes jobs where they're not necessarily interacting with, you know, front desk, but they're behind the scenes. They could be working on maintenance. They could be working cooking. They could be cleaning. And that may not sound like the best jobs for you, but I can tell you those women are so happy to have an income that it's the jobs for them. And then there is an opportunity as their skills develop and mature that they can move up within those companies. So just as an example of what's possible, and would encourage corporations to take a hard look at their needs, and also where they can build those bridges.
Well, I think I'll respond to the various questions just sort of in one response. You know, I think if someone would have asked me 5 years ago, in your experience, what is the fastest way to make change for women? What would be the single biggest thing that needs to change? And I would have said, okay, it's actually for governments to implement the laws that are currently on the books that affect women. So let's say they signed on to SID-US, which almost everybody except for the United States has done, but they don't actually implement it, right? And so what if they actually implemented that? In so many countries, you know, there are laws on the books even that say that women can own property, that women can drive in Saudi Arabia, but it's culture, obviously, that holds women back. So if we could actually just get governments to implement and hold accountable the laws that they sign on to, that would make a huge amount of change. Okay, now I believe something completely different. I've seen in the last 5 years, corporations can make a huge difference, and here's why. Corporations obviously bring a huge amount of money. In many ways, in so many countries, they're more powerful than governments. Corporations, like let's take Coca-Cola, for example, they operate in, what, 206, 207, I mean, countries around the world. So basically almost every country in the world, they're there on the ground. So when they make a major initiative announcement, like their CEO, this is not just their little foundation saying we want to do something nice for women, but their CEO, who Karen and I were with early last week, I guess it was, Muhtar Kent, wonderful man, he said, look, I want to invest in building the economic, you know, initiative and support for 5 million women, empower women economically, 5 million women by 2020. And I'm going to invest a huge amount of resources in that. And I'm doing it not just because I think it's the nice thing to do. I'm actually doing it because I think it's the smart business thing to do. Because when they look at their supply chain, they see that there's so many women-owned businesses within the supply chain. Similarly, Walmart did the exact same thing, right? And this is a multi-billion dollar initiative that they announced last year. ExxonMobil, we just partnered with Bank of America on a huge initiative to build leaders through mentoring, sending top women leaders around the world to support emerging women leaders, women like, you know, Tina Brown or Diane von Furstenberg, or, you know, top journalists and executives going out, lending visibility, credibility, and skills. So I think as corporations come into this space, I believe they will not only sort of shift the way that governments look at this, because they'll say, that's interesting, you know, so all these corporations are coming in investing in women. Maybe there's something to that. Maybe we ought to be doing the same. Obviously, they're going to affect the general population. They're putting a lot of resources into it, so they're obviously going to help women and their families. But I think it will actually shift culture. I think it'll change the way that people perceive women and their value. And that's one of the biggest barriers that we face.
Yeah, I would respond particularly to the respect question. I mean, as I mentioned before, you know, when we started doing this work, I mean, we helped develop the field. The UN Foundation helped develop the field to support adolescent girls' needs and rights. And when the UN agencies came together to form the UN Adolescent Girls Task Force and agree that they were all going to prioritize adolescent girls across their expertise and manage, that was no small feat. I mean, they knew that the data didn't, we knew that the data didn't necessarily exist. We knew when we originally started doing these works, most of them impacted men and boys. And we had to figure out, how are we going to actually get to the girls? How are we going to get to the girls 10 to 14, say, where there are gap of services that don't exist? And how are we going to actually agree to take this comprehensive approach? Because we believe that it's all interconnected. You can't just worry about her education without thinking about how is she going to be healthy, or is she going to be safe? Is she even counted? Do we even know she exists? So the seven agencies that signed that sort of mandate that said we are all going to work across this, I think it's a really big step forward in terms of us all prioritizing gender and adolescent girls.
Thanks. We'll open up. I can respond on the quality one, if you like, on the education side. I mean, I think it's terribly important. And you look at, for example, Ethiopia increased its... do you mind turning off those two mics? The ratio of girls to boys in Ethiopia rose from, I think it's 74 to 91 in 5 years. The average class size is over 100. Yeah. You know, so clearly it's not optimal by any means. So the push has been very much from a low base of getting the girls into school, girls and boys into school. But clearly there are very important issues around content and quality and so on, which the World Bank, I know, is thinking about, and I'm sure all of the other agencies as well. So I guess it's reasonable to take a phased approach. You need to get the girls in, then you need, you know, to work on the programs and the quality. But let me open. There's lots of hands up, so let's. I'll leave it to the our friend with the microphone to pass around. So we have a couple at the back too.
Hi, I'm Liz Cullen from WeConnect International, and we provide international certification for women business owners to then link them up to major corporations. So I want to piggyback on what Elise was saying, but then also what Dr. Seitz was saying, which is that, you know, we don't want to see the ministries of gender, so where gender issues are then siloed. And I think that piggybacks on what Elise is saying too, which is that the philanthropic things that corporations are doing are fantastic. They're wonderful. But at the same time, there's some major corporations who are like, well, we're giving all this money to this microfinance organizations to build business owners in Peru or, you know, Rwanda or what have you. But then you could say, well, how much are you buying from women? And they don't even know. And so there's things that are actually relatively easy. They're spending billions of dollars already. So there's things that they can do within their business, but it's just not in their business mindset. That's the philanthropic part of the organization. But I think, as you said too, as we learn and grow from each other and collaborate more, that that'll start to change also.
My name is Rick O'Sullivan. I'm with Change Management Solutions. I'm also the chair, co-chair of... I don't have... I'm also the founding co-chair of SID-Washington's Civil Society Work Group. And I've worked with Women for Women in the Balkans and with Vital Voices in the Middle East. I'd like to hammer again on the win-win issue. I also work with American associations going international. Did some work with Association for Corporate Trainers and Development, and looking at what drives training at the higher level, and we found foreign direct investment. And what drives foreign direct investment is equality of access to education. It's a key factor. And getting the message out that equality of education does not mean a zero-sum game, that educating women takes jobs away from educated men. In the Balkans, it was a major concern because we had to be very careful in terms of developing women businesses when you had a male unemployment rate of 40%, where you could actually put these women in physical danger. If their success became too visible, too obvious. So what I'd like to ask about is how do you balance the economic access with the social resistance in safety, and also in part of addressing this, getting people to think of more of a less of a zero sum, more of a win-win.
Hello, I'm Catherine, and I'm a returned Peace Corps volunteer from El Salvador. So I just wanted to direct my question particularly to Dr. Seitz. I worked with women in villages, and I have a lot of knowledge about gender development on the micro level. But you briefly mentioned about El Salvador and working with their government, and I think a bit of resistance towards gender at the beginning. I'd just like to hear about that, and as well, for the Millennium Challenge Corporation, they're working with different partners, and on the government level, what has that transition been to getting them to accept gender and for that normalization? I'd love to hear that to complement some of my local on the ground knowledge.
My name is Kadiatu. I'm from West Africa, Liberia. And you did mention Liberia. I'm very happy about that. The problem we have in Liberia, we don't have cultural differences that much. And with the gender perspective, we've done a lot. We got a gender minister. We've elected the first female president in Africa twice. And we have passed a law that if you rape, that's a lifetime imprisonment. You're not coming out. And there's so many other laws that we've enacted in the books that it's not possible in other countries where we're moving ahead. The problem we have is most of the time, the international organization or UNDP or whatsoever the giant wants, when they come in, they come in with a set goal. They have their program set. It's like, okay, we come in for girls' education, or we come in for compulsory free and primary education, or we have. But when you look at the budget they have, well, it's like 85% of the budget goes on logistics, salaries, and, you know, things that will not benefit the people on the ground. And at the end of the day, every time a project is set, the lifespan of the project, at the end of the project, when this NGO is pulling out of your country, if you do another assessment, you get to know that the beneficiaries, what will go to them would be like maybe 15 or 20% the most. The most would go back to the people. Salary, logistic cards, and other stuff, stationery and stuff. So my concern has to do with what is the mechanism put into place. At least if we can just have 50% of what you came in with, we're fine with that. Instead of coming in with 100%, you take 85 and we get 30 or 20, I don't think it's fair. That is a major concern at the governmental level, the local level, at every level. So I need the panel across to please address this issue. This is a very touching issue because I was there during the war. I've been through everything. So I know when I speak, I know from whence I speak. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Megan Dunner. I'm from the Gender Coordinator of Peace Corps. And just like Catherine mentioned earlier, volunteers work at the micro level, and many of your stories resonate with some of the work that the volunteers have done. But what I found both at the volunteer level and at the staff, Peace Corps staff level, and then in country, is that it's gender is so personality driven that often when that person, that advocate leaves, that's it. The program's gone, you know. So how do you account for that? I know that there are gender policies in place, but how do we really ensure that then that work continues? Okay.
Hi, my name is Kelly Witkowski, and I was wondering what advice you would have for those of us that don't work at organizations specifically dedicated to women's issues and that don't have large budgets to implement, such initiatives, but to whom these issues are very important. What advice you would have on how we can start to work for this in our own work that's not specifically targeted at women?
Hi, I'm Mel Schnapper. I'm a dependent consultant. I'll let that register. Okay. In any event, I've raised this issue before at another gender meeting. Why are so few men here? And if we're to talk about cultural change, why do men and maybe some women here interpret the word gender as meaning women? So you might think about working on this gender consciousness right here in Washington, D.C.
Great, thanks. Well, another excellent set of questions. We might start, should we start from the other end, Gina?
I'll defer.
Go ahead. No?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. I know you've got something to
I'm
say,
sure
Gina.
I'm sure I do. Go ahead.
Sure. Well, first off, I just want to respond to Liz from WeConnect. Liz, right?
Yep.
Yeah, okay, I thought so. And WeConnect is a fabulous organization. They're actually certifying women-owned businesses so that they can be part of the supply chain. Women-owned businesses only represent less than 1% of basically products bought. Part of the supply chain, basically products bought by multinational corporations, which is just, astounding. And there's been more and more focus, certainly, by, we talked about Coca-Cola, all the other corporations that I mentioned, on women as the drivers of economic growth. And everybody is investing in women's economic development. And although, keep investing, that's important. One of the really big problems, and we were talking about this with Coca-Cola, is that in so many countries, women actually can't own a business in their own name. There's a law against it, or there's a cultural practice that says, women just simply can't. So we need to actually address some of these larger issues of culture so that women can actually take advantage of this great training that's being provided to them. So that's the first thing that I would mention, is that corporations need to have a larger look. They need to look at some of these sort of social and legal surrounds that impact women being full participants or tapping women's full potential as part of the economy and the growth of economies around the world. The second question, and I'm sorry, your name again from Liberia? Sorry? Okay. It's a really interesting point. It's a very good point. And I think it's something that at Vital Voices we spend a lot of time thinking about. Our model is very much we don't go into a country and say, here are the 7 problems and here are our 7 solutions for solving this problem, and this is the infrastructure we're going to develop, and then one day we're going to leave, and it's obviously gone. What we do is we go into a country, we find the leaders who have the answers to the problems, and we support them to drive those solutions or to take their projects to scale to really be the answer. And one of the things that we think about all the time is, if we were to leave tomorrow, would the impact of our investments still be felt? And I think that when you invest in leaders, unlike when you invest in infrastructure, it stays beyond. And so that's something, it's very, very important. I think you should continue to ask that question of everyone that you meet in the development sector, because I think it's very important. Just to give you a little example of how I think the the international community and our approach needs to change. I don't know if all of you remember the story about the mass poisoning in Bangladesh. It was actually one of the largest sort of mass poisonings of a population in history, where the international community had built these water wells, and they were actually, there was a problem where people were being poisoned by arsenic, and a number of people were dying. And the international community came back in, and they said, oh, easy solution. We'll just paint the water wells that are poisonous red. People won't drink from them. And we'll paint the water wells that are perfectly fine to drink from green. It'll be so easy, and we'll do a major multi-million-dollar communications campaign to tell everybody about this, and it'll all be fine. Well, people took tremendous pride in these water wells. They were part of women's dowries. So you can imagine what happens now if in your village, you know, all the women now are worth nothing because now their water is tainted. So the women can't be married off, and this huge rise of human trafficking begins. Now, why did this happen? This happened because when the international community came in, they did not consult with people at a local level. They did not bring them in as their partners. They did not build the leadership of the people to come up with the solution. And so I just think that's an important example of why, you know, we need to change the way that we think about partnering with, you know, people around the world to make change, and to, I think, recognize that the solutions are there. They just need to be supported and taken to scale.
I'd actually like to address that question too, the whole project short-term funding versus sort of longer-term, more sustainable solutions. And I know that when I made the switch over to Women for Women about 9 years ago, one of the most compelling things to me in terms of how they did business was that they opened up offices and programs in the countries, and they didn't leave. They didn't leave because the money ran out or because the project was ostensibly over, even though the problem hadn't necessarily been fixed, but that this was a commitment as an organization because it fulfilled our mission. And so if you look at our oldest country program in Bosnia, for example, that we came in 1993, and we're still there. All the other development organizations have pulled out because it's not sexy. There's no money there anymore. Nobody's investing in Bosnia. It's actually quite a challenging place to do business. And yet we're still there. And one of the reasons we're still there is because the needs are still great and because our team on the ground are all local nationals, as they are in every single country where we work. So we have over 700 employees internationally across the 8 countries, and they're all local nationals. And while those offices may be connected to Women for Women International more broadly, they're still on the ground solving local issues with the local community, with local staff, primarily women in those countries. So I really support that. I think we do a disservice to development where we come in donor-driven with a set of objectives, and we say, okay, we're going to do these 5 things. Half the money is going, more than half usually, as you say, to logistics, but then the money's over, and there is no exit strategy. I hear the exit strategy a lot, even though that doesn't really happen, because if it isn't sustainable, it's not going to really help the population long-term. I also wanted to address the We Connect thing, because we've been doing a lot of corporate partnerships, as I know that Vital Voices has too, and this idea that meeting around business objectives, having the conversation around the business objectives, which is exactly what we did with Kate Spade, where it wasn't a one-off, we're not talking to a foundation, it's not considered a corporate social responsibility, but it's a way that people can come together and say, this is our mission, this is your mission, this is what you're trying to do, it's absolutely fine that you're profit-driven, and it's absolutely fine that we're mission-driven, because there is an intersect there, and we just need to find it. And I remember when with Kate Spade, we used to get all these blogs. Do you know how much they're charging for a hat? They're charging $95, you know, $100 for this hat. And I said, do you know how much they're paying each woman to make that hat? That's really the question that you should be asking, because if you can sell that hat for $115, $95, God bless you, because that makes your businesses doing better and the women are doing well. And then finally, on this question of finding that balance between, you know, particularly in countries where there's a great deal of unemployment among men, you know, how do you sell that where you're doing a women-focused program and you're trying to put women in the workforce? And I think it is a very delicate issue, and that's why that men's leadership training is so important. But this other question of, you know, we know that women reinvest in their families and communities, and more often than not, women are bringing in money into the family, and they're also bringing men into the businesses that they're starting. And so that is what we found has really made a difference, is making sure that we're looking at it in a holistic way and not just, okay, this is a woman running a business, she's leaving the family, she's going off, but she's making that strategic investment in her family and in the men too, and that it is a source of pride that the woman is earning money.
Okay, I'm going to try to address several of the questions and comments if I can. And I'll start with the question about El Salvador. And in El Salvador, remember, MCC is not a woman-focused agency. We are a U.S. government agency that has the mission of poverty reduction through economic growth. And our attention to gender is encapsulated in ensuring that projects produce, in the end, a growth of incomes among the poor over the long-term horizon. And I, Elise, my apologies, but I'll have to say infrastructure is a very good investment for reducing poverty over the long term. And it's especially beneficial to both women and men if you take advantage of those of opportunities to generate employment and other things through infrastructure. But so in El Salvador, with the first compact, we did not yet have our gender policy. We did not yet have our operational procedures and milestones. And that's the key, because we didn't require our partner to have someone with gender expertise, a social scientist, on their staff. And someone noted that in many respects, this work is dependent on an individual. And in this case, the individual had no interest at all and was actually quite, in El Salvador, in having that type of expertise on the team. And we had no teeth to ensure that happened. And another thing to remember about MCC is that we do not implement. Moving to the comment from Liberia, our countries determine the projects that they want to implement that they believe will address the constraints to economic growth. And then together with them, we go through very deep project assessment, including deep social assessment, to come up with projects that will generate income over the long term. So having real requirements as part of our contract, in a sense, with our partner countries, and having the carrot of huge compacts, huge investments, from $67 to almost $800 million over 5 years. That's a lot of money, and it's a huge point of incentive. So in El Salvador now, because we have these requirements, also because they have the government now has changed since the last compact, and they are very, very engaged in issues of gender equality, we have another moment and another opportunity. But I believe that even if that weren't the case, because our partner countries understand that we really are serious about gender at every level, that they're paying attention in ways they didn't before. I think that I'll stop there, and I'd be happy to answer other questions.
Let me at least address, I mean, I think we have a long way to go in the U.S. in terms of getting men engaged and boys engaged. I think on the international front, I think it's happening a lot quicker. Groups like Promundo, you might be familiar with, are doing a lot to engage men and boys. There's a group here in the U.S. called True Child, and they're looking at gender transformative approaches to policies and programs around reproductive health and education and violence against women by bringing in men and boys and getting them engaged in this work. I don't know what I do agree with you. I'm not sure that the work is not getting done. It's going at a much slower pace here in the U.S. In terms of getting more men and boys engaged, but it is a dialogue that we are having even at Girl Up about making sure that we're not ignoring the boys, because a lot of the brothers want to get engaged with this as well, with their sisters, to say, what about boys? We have one of our largest clubs in Garfield High School in East L.A. has 40 members, and 10 of them are boys. So they are getting engaged, maybe more so at the younger level. And maybe we need to continue to raise the consciousness of the older generations. But I think it's moving. It's just moving slowly. And I think on the international front, they're way ahead of us in that sphere. Advice, I mean, you know, the UN gives you an opportunity to connect to these issues as ordinary people like me. I mean, I feel like I'm an ordinary person. I'm not like I haven't lived my life on the global stage, but the UN actually gives you easy, accessible ways through the campaigns like our Nothing But Nets Against Malaria campaign or the Girl Up campaign to engage ordinary, everyday people. And if you're a mother or you're a non-mother or you have kids in your life or not, there's a way that you can actually find a place to engage in this global work and feel like you're having an impact from the U.S. on these issues. So I would encourage you, if you don't know much about the UN Foundation, to take a look at that. There's a lot of campaigns that might pique your interest.
And just finally, I think in terms of what to do, I mean, like the MCC, the World Bank's primary mission is not the elimination of gender inequalities. It's much more around poverty reduction. But I think the realization that various dimensions of inequality, including gender inequality, are severe breaks on and obstacles to realization of those goals means that there's a good argument for including those considerations. So the way that we're trying to pitch it now is, with respect to every operation, every activity, asking two questions. Does gender matter, and how do you know? And I think doing that on a systematic basis, whether it's a power transmission project, which is $500 million, or a roads project, or a dam, or, you know, schools, or, you know, whatever it might be, just leads to, I think, the sort of integration that we need in all the work that we do. So in that sense, I think, you know, there are important systemic generic issues, which are not, you know, I think that the work that the focused organisations is doing is incredibly important in leading the way. But I think all of us who are working in different dimensions of development have an equally important, or in fact, I think more important role to play. But let me thank the panel. It was a fabulous group of speakers here. Great audience, and happy Women's Day.